This is the award-winning Lee Pitts Live.
Brought to you by the North Law Firm. For accidents and negligent security cases, call Joe at 239-337-1191. By Southwest Florida Crime Stoppers, where you can report crimes and get paid with nobody knowing your identity. Call 1-800-780-TIPS. By Solomon's Air Conditioning Incorporated. No matter what the weather is outside, have it your way inside. Call 239-693-1569. By Regions Bank. And by Lee Health.
Southwest Florida, welcome back to Lee Pitts Live. So thrilled that you stayed with us here at Politics Central as the politicians are making their way, making their final pitches as we move towards the general election. Danika Fornear, sure you've seen her on the television show over the past couple of months. She's got a fantastic commercial we'll get a chance to take a look at. We got her here in the studio, the Alligator Lady. Welcome to Lee Pitts Live.
Thank you for having me.
How do you like that title, the Alligator Lady?
I've been called Gator Girl or Alligator Lady for many, many years now.
Why people tell people why they call you that?
I, out of high school, was an alligator wrestler for quite a few years, and that's kind of how I started learning about my community, learning about Southwest Florida, is that I wrestled alligators and then went into environmental education.
Every time somebody asks me, says, does she really wrestle alligators? What does that entail?
Well, it entails taking a 10 to 11 foot gator out of a pond of maybe 40 or 50 gators, sometimes 80 or 90 gators, pulling them out onto a cement stage and having some spotters around the area to keep an eye on the gators that are still in the pond. Jumping on the gator over the top, putting your hands down and closing the mouth,
right,
and then opening the mouth up, showing how strong their slap is when they grab things and how quick they can strike.
Right.
And basically just, it was more about, you know, it was a fancy show, but it was more about educating people about the power and strength of alligators and how dangerous they can be.
And I've seen some of those like exhibitions at like alligator farms.
Yes.
Is that where you were?
No, I did it through several different Indian reservations. One of them was Miccosukee, but several different Indian reservations have me working out there.
And here's the thing about that. If we see it in your campaign, it says something about you are willing to fight, right?
Yes.
Talk about that.
So I talk about being, I've done a lot of things. I have a diverse background, but I do talk about being an alligator wrestler because it has really made me brave and fast on my feet. I've had to learn to think fast on my feet. As a teenager with a 10-foot, 11-foot alligator, you know, I learned really quickly to think fast and to come up with solutions very quickly.
You believe in safety too, right?
Oh, yes.
Thinking fast and keeping your face covered. A good friend of mine and one of the more famous attorneys in his area, Attorney Joe North of the North Law Firm. He's been giving this to all of our guests, and he sent this for you.
Very cool. I've been going through masks like crazy, wearing them everywhere, so it'll be good to have another one. Thank you, Joe North.
All right. Why did you decide to run for political office?
So there are so many reasons that I've stepped up.
Hit the two biggies.
The two biggest reasons are that I work and I live in this community and I see the problems and I believe that I have good solutions. I believe that with all the problems we have from COVID to healthcare to environmental issues, I have really, really good solutions for it. And I believe that if I'm elected, I can really help this community improve quality of life for everybody.
So what have you been hearing? I know you mostly have to do most of your campaigning with COVID-19 in a unique way, but you're still able to communicate to the people. What stands out in terms of what are their primary concerns?
Some of the biggest concerns I'm hearing are that people are not able to feed their families and pay their rent.
Mm-hmm.
I personally, even today, Fridays, I go out and I safely with masks and social distancing, we distribute bread and food to the communities that need it the most, people that are food insecure, because that was one of the concerns that came up basically in March. I mean, we've had hungry people, but in March, it's really expanded to where the food banks are running out of food. And you know, normal places that people are able to get help are running out. Being food insecure and not being able to pay rent, being furloughed, those are two of the biggest concerns I've seen. And it's been very scary for everyone. So
When you start to hear this, as you start to move around on the campaign and talk to people, did that surprise you that was such a big factor in this area?
Unfortunately, no. Mm-hmm. I myself am a single working mom. I work two jobs to make it. I barely make them above minimum wage. I have been on food stamps. I know the struggle with food stamps.
Me too.
I have also struggled to find health care. And when I was furloughed, I had no health care. I'm a diabetic and I had no health care for several months. That was very scary. So no, I mean, I know it's affected me personally, and most of the people I know are struggling. And so that's why I want to step up and try to improve it for everybody, mm-hmm. myself included.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about District 79. Mm-hmm. With a limited amount of time, but if you were to describe your district geographically, where it's located, and demographically, the types of people in your district, income, race, and so on, go ahead and describe, lay it out for us.
It is mostly comprised of low income and middle class, working people, people working usually more than one job to make it. It includes Lehigh Acres all the way, Alva, Buckingham, all the way to North Fort Myers, and even the new Babcock area. So basically from Lehigh Acres to North Fort Myers is District 79.
How do you make contact with people right now?
It's been difficult because of the pandemic. We've been doing a lot of virtual through Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, on the website. We've been texting, calling people, and we are doing no contact literature drops. So we do pack up for all of the Democratic candidates. We pack up little bags, and then we've passed them out throughout the district, hung them on doors, and we're still doing that right now to try and get the word out. But anything we can do as safe as possible. We're also doing things like I'm doing virtual cheese making classes so I can talk to people about politics while they do something fun. Because our Zooms, you know, these Zoom meetings and these virtual campaigns are boring for people. Mm-hmm. So we've had to try and do some very exciting, interesting things just so that we give people something to do.
But one of the things I've noticed about you since I've been interacting with you, and I've been really impressed with you, is that you are a go-getter. Where did that come from? I know you wrestled alligators, but were you always you pretty much self-made, you make it happen?
Yeah, my parents, both my dad is a Vietnam veteran and was in the Air Force, and you know, he struggled to get there, and then when he got into the Air Force, they kind of helped him, but he had to work so hard as a Vietnam veteran and even afterwards struggle against the things that happen when you are deployed. My mom was a farm worker. They were a very poor rice farming family that mm-hmm. eventually became successful. So I think both my parents have worked so hard, and they've been such go-getters that they instilled that in me. But they too are a little surprised at how much I do and how much I go out and get things done. Mm-hmm. They've been very excited about me stepping up to run.
I can tell that you've been focused on the social unrest that has taken place in society. I've seen some of your social media conversations and places that I see you physically located at. You have a strong sensitivity about systemic racism, the Black Lives Matter movement, and everything else pertaining thereto. Talk about that and how you see you as a politician fitting into opportunity for everybody.
It's something so near and dear to me is I am biracial, and I've grown up experiencing different forms of racism for many years. I mean, since I was a child, but also seeing that people around me, even people that are darker skinned, have it even harder than I do, which, you know, it took me a couple of years to kind of realize just how different it can be, mm-hmm. Because I've experienced it, but sometimes not even as bad as it has been for others. For whatever reason, in the past 3 years, 3.5 years, things have gotten worse than they've ever been in some cases. And watching my friends struggle just because of the color of their skin is just, to me, it just seems so ridiculously important to address. It is so important to address it. Our families, our communities are falling apart because of the systemic racism. We're losing father figures. We're losing people that we need in the community. And yeah, it's just something I'm very passionate about. I try and do everything I can, even when I'm campaigning. Sometimes it's not part of my campaign trail, but I know that I need to be there and stand up. So yeah, I have been at quite a few protests, quite a few marches and
right.
things like that.
What do you have to say to people to say under that same umbrella of diversity, inclusion, opportunity for everybody, making America what it aspires to be, when you are in office? What do you have to say to people who say, she is not going to turn her back on us?
Oh, I definitely won't. I have several plans, several priorities and plans in place for addressing a lot of the racial injustices that are happening. I think that they are very, very good plans. If I can get into office, I think that I can build a coalition even across the aisle with some of the people that maybe don't address racism. I believe that I'm very good at that. I've been very good at that, mm-hmm. even in small communities, building coalitions. So once I get into office, because I have proven skills of being able to work with everyone from every different background, even a lot of my friends are conservative Republicans, but they believe in some of the policies I'm making. What I know is sometimes you have to appeal in an economic and financial side, and so some people need to hear that. And I know that there are ways to appeal to people to bring up a fair economy for everyone that works for basically everyone involved. So all of the legislators that I'll work for will actually be able to communicate with me, and I'll have things that work for everyone. When I'm elected, they'll see that I have so many different ways to solve these problems.
Now, you are a Democrat. In this election, though, any party can vote for you?
Yes, yes. Anyone can vote for me, and I hope that everyone will. I've been talking to, even at some of these protests, I've been talking to some of the conservative Republicans, and they've walked away with my bumper sticker. They've walked away with my buttons. They've walked away saying, I may not vote for Biden, but I will vote for you. Mm. And that's something that's been very powerful to me, because I'm able to unify and talk about how we can all work together, which is very important.
The whole process of change is in the air. It's like you can feel it on both sides everywhere, where people want change. Tell us how you represent change.
I think that I represent change mostly because I'm a unique candidate, clearly. I'm an alligator wrestler, I'm a single mom, I'm a journalist, I'm a cheesemaker and goat farmer. I've had my hands in a lot of different places, a lot of different things, from urban life to even agricultural life and being in rural areas. So I know how to work with all different communities, and I know what the problems are in most of the different communities, the struggles, and I've been able to find local solutions for those things to help people with their struggles. But I think that the reason I can make a difference is that when I am elected into state legislature, all of these interesting backgrounds that I have come to play in that I can communicate, and I have a wide knowledge base of so many different things that I think that's what sets me out to be able to make a change.
When you get elected, assuming you get elected, positive thinking, on November the 3rd, and you go into the legislature, you will go into a legislature where COVID-19 rules the day. How do you think COVID-19 has been handled so far in the state of Florida? And what are some things you would do differently or would have done differently?
Well, clearly we've had our problems. It's been out of control. Even just at home, even with my own daughter, she hasn't been able to see her friends. She hasn't been able to go to preschool or daycare. She hasn't been able to see my parents, her grandparents, as much. And that's all, I believe, because the dysfunctional leadership that has happened, we haven't listened to the medical professionals, we haven't listened to the science that shows us what we need to be doing, how we need to be going about, you know, changes and protecting our communities, protecting our kids, protecting our seniors, protecting anyone vulnerable. So I believe it's been handled poorly, but there are solutions to that. Listen to the medical experts, listen to science, and take the precautions we need to take to stop the spread or slow the spread. And then we can get back to what we need to do.
Let's take a look at your commercial.
Hi, Southwest Florida. I'm Danika Fornear. I'm running for Florida State House of Representatives in District 79. Please vote for me. As a community leader and a mom, I have learned to be a tireless advocate for those in need. I have fought fires and I've wrestled alligators. Now I'll fight for you and our community. We deserve healthy neighborhoods and a fair economy. Vote for me, Danika Fornear, by mail or at the ballot box on November 3rd. I am Danika Fornear, and I approve this message.
That's you, my mommy.
Now, in looking at your commercial, one of the things that you emphasize is water quality, the improvement of water quality in this area. That has been like in the forefront. Let's talk about that and where you see that going.
Every Wednesday, I think I'm probably one of the only candidates that is out there in the water doing science every Wednesday. We do Water Quality Wednesday, where we actually go out and test the water live on Facebook and show people what the water quality is throughout the district, different spots in the district. Yes, and we invite people to come with us. We social distance. We have canoes and kayaks for people to come with us. So if you ever wanted to learn more about water quality, you definitely should join us. It's actually a lot of fun, even though it's
hard. Can I wear my suit out there and everything?
You certainly can. I've actually done lives out there in a full dress and done some forums and candidate forums out there. But it's just a really interesting way to learn, because a lot of people don't understand that the blue-green algae that's happening, the blue-green algae blooms, the harmful algae blooms, even red tide that goes further into the saltwater, and even fecal indicator bacteria that's running through the Coosahatchee. And actually, the Coosahatchee runs from the beginning to the end of my district, so water quality is so important to me because it affects everyone in the district. Water quality, the reason it's so important is that there's so much we don't know. There's not enough funding for research, and so there's so much we don't know about how it affects us. But right now, they've realized that not only does it cause lung irritations and lung problems and asthma, it also can be linked to degenerative brain disorders like ALS and Alzheimer's. And that's a scary thing, is that we know that it's linked, but we don't know exactly how that's happening. We don't know how close you have to be to the water. Could it be that you have to be on the water? Could it be that you're a mile from the water, you live 2 miles from the water, you live 5 miles from the water? We don't know, because we haven't done the research.
How do we get to this point?
So we need to fund more research. We need to do more testing. The reason I'm out there doing citizen science and doing testing is to enter it into a database to bring awareness. If we funded more research and we did more frequent testing so that we could get all the parameters, so we could understand what's happening, and also get the signs out there, get the information out there, so we've tested the water in the areas that are populated and that are used, you know, for recreational use, showing people how dangerous it is. There are several areas where we've tested water and found terrible problems, but there's no information posted to warn people. So between making sure the community knows that, you know, that people know that the water has some problems and when it has problems, funding the research to show us what problems that can cause, because right now we have people getting sick, but we don't actually know how to find those reasons.
Oops. How did we get to this point, and who's to blame?
How did we get to this point?
Well, water quality.
Yeah, water quality.
Who's to blame? Who do you blame?
So a lot of people like to blame big agriculture and sugar, big sugar. Everyone says, oh, big sugar polluted the waterways. While they are a part of that, we unfortunately have so many different ways that pollution come into the water. Some of that is us. Some of that is our septic tanks are leaking and our wastewater systems are failing. Some of that is improved pasture and runoff. All of it is caused by nutrient overload runoff, mm-hmm. and that can be anything from septic tanks to wastewater systems to agriculture. The problem is we haven't done the research to identify the exact polluters and where that pollution is coming from, and we haven't held those polluters accountable. We have to hold polluters accountable. So there are several different ways to do that.
Are you funded by is your campaign funded by any of those big?
Oh no, my campaign is a definite grassroots shoestring budget. And I could say maybe that I wish we had some big funders, but we're completely funded by individual donations. We've had donations as small as a dollar, and we had $1.38 yesterday. Because that's what, as someone believed in me enough that that's what they could afford and that's what they gave me. No, we don't take any.
You still take a lot of pride in the fact that you are grassroots.
Oh yes. Yes, I think that because I want to be a voice for the people, and I am the people, that the people should fund me if they want me to get elected. And so that's what we've been doing. Those that couldn't afford have stepped up to volunteer to do text banking, phone banks, stuff like that, mm-hmm. even those literature drops like I talked about. We know that people are struggling, and so donating to a campaign is difficult or impossible. Mm-hmm. I've actually been completely disgusted by the amount of money that goes into a political campaign when some of these candidates could be buying single family homes mm-hmm. with what they're doing, or several single family homes. So yes, I'm very proud to say that I'm grassroots and individually, you know, small donation funded.
Are you in favor of legalizing marijuana, and what problems do you have with the criminal justice system?
I definitely support, it's one of my three main priorities. I want to legalize the adult use of cannabis. Number one, because that will help our economy be more resilient and stable. It will fund state programs without us having to raise taxes, and none of us want to raise taxes, right? So being able to find a way that's a stable source of revenue for the state to also fund state programs without raising taxes, and you know, we rely on tourism dollars, but how has that worked out for us? With the pandemic, with hurricanes, you know, we keep taking these hits. With marijuana, we wouldn't have those things. It would be a much more resilient, stable way to have income to fund state programs. With the criminal justice system, that to me goes hand in hand with legalization of marijuana, because we've had so many people that have been locked up for recreational use or locked up for sales even. And people are doing it anyways. They're trying to make ends meet. Marijuana helps veterans. It helps people with epilepsy. It helps people with PTSD. And without that, you know, people are doing it anyways. If we legalize it, then we're putting people, and it actually is a racial justice issue as well, because across the board, all races, when they do the research, I don't know the exact statistics, but across the board, all races use marijuana at the same level. There's the same, but four or five times more often, people of brown and black communities are arrested, are charged, are institutionalized, are taken, and prosecuted. That's clearly a racial justice issue, but if we legalize it and we expunge the records and we got everyone back into their communities, there are so many people sitting in there that have been put in the criminal justice system for a plant, a helpful plant. You know, I can only just say, can you imagine the change that would happen if we could get those people out, get their records expunged, get them back into working jobs where those records have held them back from being able to go back to work, and the community could be lifted up from that. So yes, I definitely, definitely support the legalization of marijuana.
What do you like least about living in Florida? You're part of the country, and what do you like most?
What do I like least? I guess that's sort of a combination question, because what I love about living here is listening to people's story, meeting people and listening to their stories, and I've met so many different people from so many different, because I do so many things, I've met so many different people from so many different areas, and listening to their stories is my favorite part. But my least favorite part is some of those stories are serious struggle. Some of those stories are filled with depressing, tragic loss, and a struggle to survive, a struggle to put food on the table. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of, you know, it's a double bind. I really love hearing their stories, but sometimes finding those solutions to help them is difficult.
You're very passionate. I think you're going to make a great representative for this, for your district. I want you to take a look at that camera and take 30 seconds and make a case for Danica.
Okay. I'm Danica Fornear. I'm running for State House District 79. And my diverse background as an alligator wrestler, a former firefighter, a goat farmer, a cheesemaker, a single mom, and a journalist is just showing everyone that I have enough skills, all these different skills that can really make me a great leader and really affect community change in our community for the positive. So I hope that you will come and get to the polls or vote by mail or even vote early. Vote for Danica Fornear. If you need any more information, my website is www.fornearforflorida.com. Thank you.
Finally on Leap Is Live. As the saying goes in this particular show, for those who say it can't be done, they're usually interrupted by those like Danica Fornear and all the fine people who are associated with her campaign who are doing it. We'll see you next week.
Lee Pitts Live is a Lee Pitts Enterprise production.
Hello, Southwest Florida. Thanks for watching Lee Pitts Live. Of course, I'm Lee Pitts. I hope you enjoy that particular show, but you can always catch us here on YouTube. Just click on the subscribe button down there. That way you can get your Lee Pitts Live on demand when you want it and how you want it. We also encourage you to watch our show on Fox 4 and connect with us on all our social media platforms. Just type in Lee Pitts Live.